السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبيه الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد. Today is our day two of explaining the book Fiqh al-Sunnah. As we said, we now start off with the book. The author began by Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, said in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. He brought a verse in Surah Al-Hashr, the seventh verse in it, which says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Prophet, peace be upon him, came with to you, take it. And whatever the Prophet, peace be upon him, forbade you from, refrain from it, leave it away. For example, the Prophet, peace be upon him, came to us with Sunnah. So we should take it from him. Then he also forbade us from innovation in the religion, or what we call bid'ah. So we should refrain, we should do away with it. That is an advice from the context we have just read. But when you look at the reality we are in now, we have taken the opposite direction. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. It's like we are not aware of the dangers of innovation or bid'ah, the dangers of bid'ah. Allow me put on board these three points on the dangers of bid'ah. The first point is, did you know that any deed done out of innovation, however good it might look, its owner gains no reward from it? The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, "Man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad." Whoever comes up with any deed under innovation, under bid'ah, that deed will be given back to him or her. It will be rejected by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. It will not be taken by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Because إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه. Allah only takes the good deeds from us. That deed is not counted amongst the good deeds. That's why it is left to you. It is rejected from you. Secondly, did you know that you get a sin because of making an innovation in the religion? Not only that, and whoever will copy it from you, you will get a sin unto that person till the day of judgment. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, وَمَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً سَيِّئَةً فَعَلَيْهِ وِزْرُهَا وَوِزْرُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever innovates any deed in the religion, any bad deed in the religion of Islam, he is held guilty and will be onto a sin, will have committed a sin because of that. Not only that, and whoever will copy it from him or her, he will be receiving an equal sign of it till the day of judgment. Subhanallah. Then point three, and the last point for now, did you know that by you making any innovation in this religion, it's like you are saying that there is certain information which the Prophet, peace be upon him, hid from us. Imam Malik bin Anas rahimahullah, he said, وَمَنْ ابْتَدَعَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ بِدَعَةً يَرَاهَا حَسَنَةً فَقَدْ زَعْمَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا خَانَ الرِّسَالَةِ. Whoever innovates any deed in this religion, claiming that it's good, it's like this person has claimed that there are certain informations which the Prophet, peace be upon him, hid from us. Subhanallah. Do you see how dangerous that is? Let's do away with bid'ah, with innovation in the religion. Then after, the book was commented onto by various people like Hassan al-Banna. We shall not read his commentary. We shall skip it. Then the author himself also made his on page 7. What I'm interested most on his preface or introduction is how he ended it. He said, وَهَذِهِ مُحَاوَلَاتٌ أَرَدْنَا بِهَا خِدْمَةُ دِينِنَا. These kinds of struggles of we writing such kind of information, we wanted nothing from it except serving the religion of Allah, our religion. Not only that, وَمَنْفَعَةٌ لِإِخْوَانِنَا وَمَنْفَعَةُ إِخْوَانِنَا. Not only that, we also wanted to benefit our brothers and sisters. Just see us now, we are benefiting from his book, Fiqh Sunnah. Then he said, وَأَيْ يَجْعَلَ عَمَالَنَا خَالِصًا لِوَجْهِهِ الْكَرِيمِ. And we pray that may Allah, وَنَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ أَنْ يَنْفَعَ بِهَا. We pray that may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala make it of a benefit to people. وَأَيْ يَجْعَلَ عَمَالَنَا صَالِحًا لِوَجْهِهِ الْكَرِيمِ. And that he makes our deeds, this deed of ours, with sincerity that we want to make him happy. We want to get pleased by him. وَهُوَ حَسْبُنَا وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ. Allah is sufficient from us, and to him is where one will never regret making a backbone of his deeds. Then we proceed a preface that is Tamhid. We shall leave it out because we summarized it in series number 1, so we shall not go back to it again. Then let's go straight to page 15. Page 15, where there is at-tahara, purification. Speaking of at-tahara huna, purification, we have included the physical purification, like using water, or judgmental purification, like purifying yourself using soil, at-tayammam. You are purifying yourself, but it is not physical, it is judgmental. Then the physical one is using water, which we all know. The author says, Al-miyahu wa aqsamuha, water and its categories. He says, Al-qismu al-awwalu min al-miyahi, the first category of water we are going to talk of here about here is al-ma'u al-mutlaq. This is general water, free, absolute, pure water. Said, وَحُكْمُهُ, its ruling, أَنَّهُ طَاهِرٌ, أَنَّهُ طَاهُورٌ, is that this water is used for purification. أي, that means, أَنَّهُ طَاهِرٌ فِي نَفْسِهِ, itself is clean, مُطَهِّرٌ لِغَيْرِهِ, and it is used for purification. وَيَنْدَرِجُ تَحْتَهُ مِنَ الْأَنْوَاعِ مَا يَأْتِي, and under it comes these examples. The first example, ma'u al-matari, rain water, wath-thalji, snow water, wal-baradi, and ice water. All these examples of waters are clean and qualified to be used for purification. Why? لِقَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, because of the verse of Allah where he said, وَيُنَزِّلُ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً لِيُطَهِّرَكُمْ بِهِ, and he, Allah, sends to you from the sky water so that you use it for purifying yourselves, so that he purifies your soul, he purifies you people with it. This is in Surah Al-Anfal, verse 11. Not only that, وَقَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, and the verse of Allah where he said, وَأَنْزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً طَهُورًا, and we sent from the sky water which is clean. That means it's used for cleanliness. That is in Surah Al-Furqan, verse 48. وَلِحَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالَ, and because of the tradition which was narrated by Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا كَبَّرَ فِي الصَّلَاةِ, the Prophet, peace be upon him, whenever he could make takbira, takbiratul ihram, which takes him into salah, the first takbira. Whenever he could make the first takbira in salah, that Allahu Akbar, سَكَتَ هُنَيْهَا, he could make silence a while. He could keep silence a while قبل القراءة, before him reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. فقلت, Abu Huraira says, then I said, Ya Rasul Allah, O you the messenger of Allah, Bi Abi Anta wa Ummi. This is a statement used by the Arabs to dignify the addressee, to dignify somebody he or she is addressing. He said, O you the messenger of Allah, أَرَأَيْتَ سُكُوتَكَ بَيْنَ التَّكْبِيرِ وَالْقِرَاءَ, do you see the silence you normally make between your takbirat al-ihram and reciting surah al-fatiha? ماذا ما تقول, ما تقول, what do you normally recite in between there? قال, the prophet said, اللهم, أقول, I say, اللهم, O Allah, بَاعِد بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ خَطَايَايَ, put a distance between me and my mistakes and sins, كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب, the same way you put a distance between the east and the west. اللهم نقني من خطاياي, O Allah, purify me from my mistakes and sins, كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس, just as the way a white cloth is purified from that. Allahum, from that. Naam, yes, that. Thatness, filthiness, the sort. Allahumma ghusilni min khatayai, O Allah, wash me from my mistakes and sins, bithalji wal ma'i wal baradi, using snow and water and ice. Our scholars say the Prophet, peace be upon him, used these three items, snow, water, and ice, because he was talking of sins, and these sins incur punishments, amongst which is hellfire. Hellfire is hot, so he spoke of these totally cold three items to show you how they are going, how he wants himself to be definitely cleaned from the heat of hellfire, which can be incurred because of his sins. He says, "Rawahu al-Jama'a," all the authors of the traditions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, came up with this tradition of Abi Huraira, illa Tirmidhi, except Imam Tirmidhi in Sunan Tirmidhi is the one who never brought that hadith up. The rest of his fellows brought it up. That is the first category. The second category, he said, ma'ul bahri, ocean water. Ocean water. You can as well pull the lake, river water. Now, he said, this water is also clean. Why? Li hadithi Abi Huraira, because of the tradition which was narrated by Abi Huraira, radiyallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, قال, said, سأل رجل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. One day, a man approached the Prophet, peace be upon him, and made an inquiry. فقال, he said, يا رسول الله, O you the messenger of Allah, إنا نركب البحر, we sometimes go overseas, either by boat, by ship. Yes, we go overseas, we go above waters, we flow above waters. Yes, we sail on top of waters with any sailor used to be to sail goods or commodities or people on water like boats and ship. He said, وَنَحْمِلُ مَعَنَا الْقَلِيلَ مِنَ الْمَا. And whenever we are sailing onto water, we normally carry with us limited water. We carry with us limited water. Remember, a boat, a ship has its limit of the tons, the kilograms it should bear, it should carry. When you exceed it, you are in danger. So he said, whenever we are going on waters, we carry limited water with us. Whereby, فَإِن تَوَضَّأْنَا بِهِ عَطِشْنَا. If we say that when time for salah comes and we have to get ablution, we use it, it will get over. And what will happen to us? We shall get thirsty because we shall not be having water with us because they could not take ocean water, lake water, river water. So the only water they could take is this one they have carried along with themselves. Then he asked the Prophet, peace be upon him, that, O you the messenger of Allah, أَفَنَتَوَضَّأُ بِمَاءِ الْبَحْرِ. Should we use the ocean water, the lake, river water to get ablution? فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. At this juncture, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, he made a broad judgment over such kinds of waters and what is related onto them. He said, هُوَ الطَّهُورُ مَاءُهُ. Ocean water, lake water, river water. It is a body, a water body, which its waters are clean. That means they qualify to be used for ablution. Not only that, الْحِلُّ مَيْتَتُهُ. And whichever is found dead in it is also permissible to be consumed by a person, by a human being. Yes, the first statement has no problem. The Prophet, peace be upon him, showed us the purity of this water, lake water, river water, ocean water, maybe spring water and the salt. He showed us that all these waters are clean. But again, he incurred in another judgment that also whatever found in it is also, whatever found in it dead is also allowed to be consumed by we human beings. Now, here comes ideas from our scholars about what this statement means. What was the Prophet, peace be upon him, really meaning? Was he meaning that anything which is found dead in water is allowed to be eaten, to be consumed by us? Or there are specifications which the Prophet, peace be upon him, wanted? Some scholars said, yes, whatever is found dead in water, first of all, they all agreed that if this particular item, if this particular dead living is fish, they all agreed. There is a consensus, an assent from all of them that has no problem. Fish has no problem. That when you find it dead on waters, you are allowed to eat it. You know, except when maybe you knew of intoxicants which were put in this water, which might have caused the death of this fish, and maybe these intoxicants which were poured in this water are also dangerous to our lives. That is when we say leave it. Otherwise, a natural death, fish has no problem to be consumed, even if you have found it dead in waters. Then, difference in views came in. Others said, Yes, everything. Apart even leaving out fish, any other living thing which is found dead in water, we are allowed to consume it. We are allowed to consume it. Well, here they are meaning things which live in water. Things which live in water specifically. These are things, living things, animals. Yes, creatures which live specifically in water, not on land. They say, yes, anything which lives in water, when it's found dead, it is allowed to be consumed. And that is a view of Imam Malik and others. Then others said, no, apart from fish, any other living thing which lives in water, when found dead, we are not allowed to consume it. Yes, and that is a saying of the Al-Hanafiya, Imam Abu Hanifa and his students. That is their view. Then others said, yes, everything which lives in water, when found dead in it, it's allowed to be consumed, except two things. Except a frog and a snake. They said, these two, no. Apart from these two, the rest, you have no problem to consume them. And this is a view of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and other scholars. Then others said, no, we have to look through these issues. There are things, there are creatures which live both on, which live in water, and they have, they are alike online, on land. They have creatures on land which have the same features or the same name, those which are in waters. You see, they said, so we have to look through this issue. When this kind of creature which has been found dead in the waters has features like that one which lives on land and it is allowed to be eaten, then it has no problem. It has no problem. We have such kinds of creatures. Then they said, and if this creature which has been found dead in waters and it lives in water, as it's alike on land, and its alike is not permissible to be eaten, to be consumed by human beings, then we shall say it is not allowed to be eaten, however much we have found it dead in waters, like a porpoise. A porpoise, those who know a porpoise, it is called khinzirul bahr. It is called the pig of water, the pig which lives in water. So, since a pig is not allowed to be consumed on land, even this porpoise, which has been found dead in waters, and indeed it lives in waters, it is not allowed to be consumed by we human beings. That is how our scholars came up with their views onto that issue. And, you know, for purposes of reference, you can get such the different views from our scholars about this in books like Tuhfatul Ahwazi. Tuhfatul Ahwazi, it is a book where its author explained the book Sunan al-Tirmidhi. Tuhfatul Ahwazi fi sharh Sunan al-Tirmidhi. Written by Abu al-Ala Muhammad Abd al-Rahman ibn Abd al-Rahim ibn Abd al-Rahim al-Mubarak Furi, and other books which have the same references, you can go and relate to them. I think we shall stop onto that. The next session, the next series, day three, we shall look at the second category of voters, inshallah. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala make us more knowledgeable. Wa subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.